the same source, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of that school of thought, Imam Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah, who is a very proliferative imam, very encyclopedic and having knowledge in depth, and his ideas are so straight to the straight bullseye. It really, when you read a statement of a statement, you find this man knows what he's talking about. He's also on the school of thought of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and they never been called extremist or anything of that. Imam al-Dhahabi and Imam ibn Daqiq al-Eid, Imam ibn Qudam al-Maqdisi, greatest names in Islam, you find them on the school of thought. Of course, we find as great imams following Imam Shafi'i, like Bukhari and Muslim and so on, and you find others following Imam Malik. And so this kind of, it's artificial division we created by us who are looking at the past. From their perspective, they were not in any sect or group or parties or any division. They were Muslims. They see things that way. I gave an analogy of it like the Supreme Court. Who thinks the Supreme Court are divided and fighting? And many issues, you find the single issue, some people vote yes, others say no, others stay neutral or excuse themselves from giving opinion. That's the way it should be. Because any issue, you look at it from different vantage point, it gives you different opinion, and this is what happens. So we should not be, we should be relaxed, not to be spastic. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal had two big fitna or big tests in their lives. One from the Khulafa of Bani Abbas, especially three of them, Al-Ma'mun and his brother Al-Mu'tasim and his son Al-Wathiq. In what we call Mihnat Khalq al-Qur'an. It is an issue worth a penny, created by those quasi-philosophers who were influenced whatever been translated from the Greek and formed a group called Al-Mu'tazila. And if you believe in conspiracy theories, you find so many suspicious hands in it. An issue should not even be talked about because the brain and the mind and reason has nothing to do with it. This is of things of faith, alam al-ghayb. At any rate, when Harun al-Rashid knew who started this fitna, vowed if he catch him, he would punish him by law. But they disappeared underground. And when his son was fascinated by the philosophy, and he did a great job in translating most of the Greek knowledge of mathematics and physics and Aristo writings, and unfortunately they translated the metaphysic, and here where the problem started. And his prime minister, who was relatively a faqih and good guy, Ahmad ibn Abi Duad, but whenever you carry things to the extreme, it gives you a paradox, and this is what happened. And I'm gonna repeat this a lot, the paradox. Because many of our issues, you look at it, you find this is by intuition. You don't need to be a scholar or faqih or philosopher to know it. If you love sugar in tea, one spoon is enough, one and a half. You tell him that's enough, one and a half too much. Okay, thank you. But if you tell me I love sugar in tea and I put 2 pounds sugar in this little cup of tea, I spoil it. Then what is this? Or if I don't put you any drop of tea, sugar in that tea, you say, well, I cannot drink it. So everything exceeds is like starvation. It's too bad to find people dying of starvation. But it's also too bad to die from polemia and from overweight. So this paradox, whenever you carry any issue to the extreme, it gives you opposite results. So what happened in this fitna, which many other imams really, they knew they are crazy. They escaped by thinking, or at least treating them what they deserve. Like Imam Shafi, when he was brought in to be tested, and they told him, do you believe that this Quran was created? He was smart enough to get rid of all these stupid, crazy inquisitors. He told them, the Zabur, the Torah, the Injil, and the Quran. Those four are created by God. So they liked what he said. Okay, but here the gimmick or the catch, that he said those four, means for his four fingers, were created by God, and they let him go. This is the situation Imam Abu Hanifa faced when those Khawarij, they were chopped the head of every Muslim, unless he says we are mustajir. So when they came to Abu Hanifa and he was in the masjid, a gang of them came swarmed with swords. How do you treat this kind of fanatics? He told them, of course, we are mustajir. Give us 4 months. Oh, okay, you have 4 months. Go. They escaped of this madness. But the situation got very worse at the time of Mu'tasim and so on. And several people fell into that fitna because the Quran is not makhluq. It is Allah, Kalamullah. We don't need to go into waste our time in this issue, which is dead. But it was dead because of the efforts of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, who stood fast and refused to accept that proposition. And he was imprisoned for close to 15 years. He was tortured years and years. And several of his friends escaped by this way of Imam Shafi'i did some. And others did not, and they died in prison. We will come to that. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, after Al-Mutawakkil came, and he realized that this nonsense is costing a lot of efforts and resources and division and so on, he canceled all of this issue and punished the perpetrators, and it was over. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, after this incident, became a giant in the eyes of the whole Muslim Ummah. He has really been tested, he's solid gold. After this fitna, after this mihna, we in Arabic we call it mihna to khalq al-Quran. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, because of that, and this is when you go